Roll call.
Nager, Prince, Tal, Tolbert, Yang, Jalali, Council President Brennan Moen, seven present, no one absent.
We invite you to stand and join us for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Consent agenda items 2 through 7 are before you for your consideration.
I think we need a pinch hitter here for Ms. Moore. Item number 5 is taken for separate consideration. Is there anything else that needs to be considered separately? All right, seeing none, Ms. Yang moves consent agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The consent agenda is adopted as amended. Item number 5, resolution 20-110. Authorizing the city to enter into a cooperative agreement with MnDOT and Ramsey County regarding the replacement of the Dale Street Bridge at Trunk Highway 94.
Mr. Tal.
Thank you, Council President. I want to pull this item out so that I could read into the record some of the commitment from Ramsey County and MnDOT. This is a project that will be, we're hoping that it will start later this year into next year on the Dell Street Bridge. And so some of that traffic will also be detour over to Lexington. So I think that this is a critical time for us to, as part of our AMRO mail road conversation. I want to read this for the record. Being that this is a federally funded project, a disadvantaged business enterprise, or DBE, goal is required to receive the funding. MnDOT Office of Civil Rights oversee this program and determines the goal for projects. This program is in place to ensure women and minority-owned businesses have the opportunity to participate in contracts. The goal for the Dell Street was 9.5% with the contractor, which the contractor has met. The county MnDOT monitors the goal as the project is completed. Ramsey County has a workforce goal for both women and people of color. The women's goal was 20% and the people of color goal was 32%. This is not only cover the prime contractor, but all the subcontractors performing work on the project as well. Ramsey County has hired TKD to perform the construction administration and inspection on the project. TKDA has hired a subcontractor, IMO Consulting Group, to provide for inspection services on the project. IMO is a DBE, minority-owned company that's located in the Twin Cities. TKDA hired Micah Anders to provide communication and coordination expertise. Micah is a local to the project and is one of the artists providing work and ideas for the project. TKDA hired Martinez Gio Parcho to provide aerial photography. Martinez is a minority-owned business located in the Twin City. Ramsey County Workforce Solution will be heavily involved in the project as well. John O'Phelan with the Workforce Solutions has put together a job fair for the construction trades on April 30th. This job fair will help local find opportunity not only with regards to the Dell project, but within the construction industry that will provide employment opportunity for years to come. Workforce Solution is also working with many unions in the metro area to provide information on joining and job opportunity within the unions. And number 5, lastly, Ramsey County is also looking to hold a project kickoff event that will provide opportunity for the community to come learn about the projects. Ideas are still being put together regarding the event, including ideas and project table to field questions about the project itself. A workforce solution table, a table with union representative. This event is yet to be finalized.
Thank you, Mr. Tao. Any discussion on this item? And I do appreciate taking the time to read that out loud and into the record. It's important information about this project. My ears perked up when you mentioned Micah, who was a great civic prodigy from the area, so that's great. If there's no further discussion, Mr. Tom moves approval. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The resolution is adopted.
Ms. Nager moves to suspend the rules. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails. Ms. Nager moves reconsideration of item 20-19. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion prevails. Ms. Nacre.
Thank you. I appreciate my colleagues' consideration in allowing me to recall this item for reconsideration. This was the hours exception to 333 Sibley that we passed last week. I wanted to clarify that I'm first of all very much a supporter of our Skyway system and of guaranteeing access through the system. And it was really important to me, looking back at the record from last week, to clarify that the basis on which I moved to grant the hours exception that was requested was, first and foremost, the fact that an alternate Skyway route exists that is so closely parallel to the one through 333 Sibley that is equally convenient as that corridor and that does not cause any detour for people traversing between the two bridges at either end. And my second reason for granting the exception was that there's no commercial activity in the building. I just wanted to clarify those two things because should either of those conditions change, so for example, should the corridor directly parallel to the 333 easement no longer be accessible, I would consider the basis for the exception to be invalid, and I would welcome a petition from the Skyway Governance Advisory Committee to this body to withdraw the exception. So I wanted to state those things on the record because I think that's really important for the integrity of our Skyway system. Also, since last week we did not have a staff report available, I'm aware that Bill Hanley, who chairs the Skyway Governance Committee, is here, and I wanted to give him the chance to come up and share his thoughts as well.
Welcome. Thanks for being here.
Good afternoon. Thank you. I have worked for the last 31 years in the Skyway system, most of that time at TPT as an executive vice president doing public engagement work. We take that kind of work pretty seriously, created a bunch of projects, including Almanac, during that period. Also, now live in the Skyway system for the last 5 years and have been on the Skyway Governance Advisory Committee for 4 years. Appreciate this chance to clarify this, and Councilmember Nacre has been just terrific to give us this opportunity. We heard from 333 Sibley three times. This was serious work. In my 4 years, this is probably the issue that came up the most and that we gave the most time to. We voted overwhelmingly twice to deny this request. And let me just walk you through a little bit of why that was. First thing they brought to us was essentially mild public safety issues. All the things we're familiar with. People sleeping in the Skyway, creating messes in the Skyway, throwing up in the Skyway, all of the things that are minor property damage. They could provide us with no real proof of that, no data. I then went and talked to Commander Ellison personally and said, anything that we could use as an excuse to allow this closure? Nothing, no sort of hotspot, nothing that showed any increased police activity. So that didn't seem justifiable. Again, we're talking about closing the Skyway permanently. 4 years ago, we gave them an hours exception, so we allowed them to operate not on weekends and all of that. Now they're talking about closing it completely. Second one was just a general sense of many of our residents feel uncomfortable with people in our Skyway that we don't recognize. We asked them for some data on that because they didn't come initially with any data. They provided us from their 180 or 200 residents, they provided us with 7 letters that did in fact say we're uncomfortable with the fact that there are people in our Skyway that we don't recognize and we make us sometimes feel mildly threatened. Again, not unusual. Many of us live in the Skyways. We all work in the Skyways. This is not an unusual thing. You're living downtown. This is part of what life is like. Another issue they hit us with, there is no publicly facing commercial space in our building, meaning nothing that the public would have to come into, no coffee shops, no anything. They do have leasable space on the first floor, but they've never been successful in leasing it. They said, we think this is an excuse to close this Skyway. The committee is extremely concerned about this. The precedent that we would set by allowing that would immediately invite other organizations, other buildings to come to the committee and come to the council and ask for an exception. The most prominent one could be Cray Plaza. Because as you know, Ted Bigos has stated his intention to turn the entire building residential. He would have every right, I think, to say we would claim the same exception. There's been some talk about 333 being at the end of the line. It technically isn't at the end of the line, but as Councilmember Nacre said, it is parallel to another very close, and as you just got done saying, very close pathway through 180 East 5th. What I apparently didn't communicate effectively is that amazingly coincidentally, that parallel space is probably the primary space people use. It's been that way for the 31 years I've been in the Skyway system. 2 months ago, it closed. That is to say, the new owners of 180 East 5th ordered it closed in the evenings and on weekends. So it's only open during the weekdays. So it's basically, without any permission from you or from us or endorsement, they just declared that they're gonna do it. This morning I went back and talked to Nan Hines, who manages the building. I said, any update in your status? Are you rethinking this? Could we possibly get you? No, they're committed to going ahead and continuing to do this. They're in a process now with DSI and the city attorney or something. But we would plead with you, until that's resolved, please don't consider closing 333 Sibley. There was something stated that perhaps the committee had a divided vote or something. It was not at all divided. It was overwhelming twice. The confusion was, the first time we voted it, we couldn't find a second. Somebody nominated and no one else on the committee would do it. And so we turned it back and basically it was a null. We thought that by not approving the closure, it was the same as denying the closure. City attorney told us, no, you've got to actually overtly deny the closure. We voted it again the next month. We heard it again the next month. We voted it again, exactly the same. I think there was only one vote against it. So number one, it's a non-urgent issue. There's nothing urgent about it. They've taken a little bit of time to do this, so I think we could afford to wait. I certainly, and the committee would certainly hope that you would delay until the 180 thing is resolved. And even once it is resolved, there is a concern that we'd be setting a precedent that would be negative. I did offer to the management of 333 Sibley that I thought there might be some benefit if I organized a conversation between them and the security of Union Depot, TPT, 180 East 5th, and Cray Plaza to get them together to talk about mutual concerns. They didn't take me up on that offer. They didn't seem interested. But I do think that would be a positive step for us going forward to get them all talking about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you so much. Ms. Naker.
Thank you. Thanks again, Mr. Hanley. And I also I appreciate that Mr. Hanley mentioned this. I misstated last week that it had been a divided vote. And in fact, it had not been divided. There was, as Mr. Hanley said, a time when they did not take action and then a meeting where they did, but the committee itself was not divided. I appreciate the point about 180 East 5th. It is an illegal closure right now, and we are taking enforcement action against it, so it is not allowed by us. And so I continue to feel that this closure is justified, but if at any time the 180 East 5th closure was allowed, if there were an official exception granted, then that would call this exception into question. So continue to move approval of my recommendation for last week.
All right, thank you. Any discussion on that motion? Ms. Prince.
I'm just wondering, when do you think the 180 East 5th issue will be resolved? Does it make sense for us to lay this over until such time as?
We are moving at all possible speed with DSI.
To enforce.
So I don't have a timeline from them, but it has not been permitted. It's not a legal closure right now. So,
okay. Ms. Prince,
I will support your motion, but I hope we know that we can stay on top of that. The other thing is, I also am aware of how of what a tough thing this is to be consistent with our skyways, and we had an issue I think about a year and a half ago that was extremely difficult and emotional, and we kept the skyway open, and so the integrity of the system is really important to all of us. I know it is to you, and so I hope we can get that resolved quickly, and I appreciate that you've conditioned the closure on keeping 180 open.
I appreciate you saying that, and I think that was why it was so important to me to make sure we had this conversation, also to hear from Mr. Hanley and the Skyway Governance Committee at a meeting, because I do think there's nowhere else in the system do two parallel corridors exist like this, and I can't imagine there being another case where these circumstances would apply and where I would consider an exception for those reasons, but wanted to be really clear about that. So,
Great. So there is a motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The resolution is adopted as it was amended last week. Item number 8, final adoption of Ordinance 20-4, granting the application of Bond Fee Properties, LLP, to rezone property at 337 7th Street West, 366 Smith Avenue North, and 372 Smith Avenue North from T2 to T3 traditional neighborhood and amending Chapter 60 of the Legislative Code pertaining to the zoning map.
This is before us for final adoption, slide over a few times, but I think this is it. Ms. Dinker?
Moves approval.
Moves approval. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The ordinance is adopted. Item number 9, Resolution Public Hearing 20-11, amending the financing and spending plan of the Department of Parks and Recreation in the amount of $250,000 to reflect Department of Natural Resources Land and Water Conservation Fund fiscal year 2018 Outdoor Recreation Legacy Partnership Program grant funds received from the Midway Peace Park project.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Mr. Tom moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Item number 10, Resolution Public Hearing 20-6, amending the financing and spending plan of the Department of Parks and Recreation in the amount of $50,000 for the 2019 Round 2 Cultural Star grant funds received for the Rice Park Revitalization Lighting Project.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Ms. Dinker moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Item number 11, Resolution Public Hearing 20-64, amending the financing and spending plan of the Department of Parks and Recreation in the amount of $200,000 for the STAR grant funds received for field renovation at Conway Recreation Center.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Ms. Prince moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Item number 12, Resolution Public Hearing 20-52, approving the application of Patrick McGoverns for sound level variance for amplified music for a Lucky Palooza 2020 event in an enclosed tent on March 14th at 225 7th Street West.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Ms. Anker moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Item number 13, Resolution Public Hearing 20-53, approving the application of Patrick McGoverns for a sound level variance for amplified music for St. Patrick's Day 2020 event in a closed tent on March 17th at 225 7th Street West.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Ms. Anker moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Item number 14, Resolution Public Hearing 20-54, approving the application of Cassettas for a sound level variance for amplified music for a St. Patrick's event on March 14th at 211 7th Street West.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Ms. Naker moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Item number 15, Resolution Public Hearing 20-55, approving the application of Cassettas for a sound level variance for amplified music for a St. Patrick's Day event on March 17th at 211 7th Street West.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Seeing none, Ms. Naker moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The public hearing is closed and the resolution is adopted. Legislative hearing, consent agenda items 16 through 22 are before you for your consideration.
Good afternoon, Ms. Mormont.
Good afternoon, Council President, Council Members. I would ask that item number 19 be pulled from the agenda, please.
Item number 19, RLH RR 19-29, ordering the rehabilitation or raising and removal of their structures at 864 Marion Street within 15 days after December 18th, 2019, City Council public hearing, Public hearing is continued from December 18th.
Ms. Borman.
Council President Brennan, council members, I originally heard this case back at the end of November of 2019, so we're now looking at 90 days that I've been working on this file. When it originally came to me, we did not have a code compliance. We did not have a $5,000 performance deposit. The title wasn't in the owner, I'll say owner's name. It was in the previous owner's name, according to all our title work. And that couple, both of them are deceased. So we had a lot of problems to overcome right out of the gates, trying to get this ready to come forward as a prospect to have the council grant time for its rehabilitation. The performance deposit was posted per my request in December prior to your first public hearing. Also in that directive was that a code compliance inspection would be applied for. It was understood at that time by me that that did mean that the house would be ready to be inspected. It was not. The house was full and it was not ready to be inspected. Also, the owner did not provide a lockbox combination so that the inspectors would have access to the property. So I do feel like that was definitely a half measure towards what was required. With respect to the title work, there was a very direct request that if the title work could not be updated in the recorder's office, that legal action was necessary, that there be a demonstration that legal action had been initiated to clear the title and put it into Mr. Schilling's name. Mr. Schilling indicates he's been in possession of the property since the mid-1970s, but again, it is in the previous owner's name at this time. Mr. Schilling came forward, and that actually led me to the recommendation that is in front of you now to order the building removed within 15 days because there hadn't been traction on those items. The city cannot issue a building permit to someone who doesn't own the property. As of today, and I've just been meeting with Mr. Schilling in the hallway, actually, he's indicated he has hired an attorney to do some title work. He has brought in a tax statement from the mid-1970s that shows that he was at least the taxpayer of record in the mid-1970s. He has had a contractor look at the house. Right now I'm looking at a two-sentence statement from the contractor, which wouldn't constitute a work plan on how to fix the house. But because there has been some movement and the house is cleaned out and ready to be inspected, I hesitantly ask that you would refer the matter back into legislative hearing for this to be reviewed a little bit more carefully, and if we actually have an attorney moving forward trying to get these title issues addressed, and if he can show money and a work plan and so on, then this may be a prospect for rehabilitation. I don't know, and I don't know that the owner would choose that after the inspection. That's something that people get information about when they get the bids. Just to give you some context, I have a photograph of the house for the overhead camera there. So that is in the near north end. So I think the owner is here and would like to address the council.
Mr. Tao.
Marcia, can you clarify, how long has this building been, or this property been vacated or abandoned?
This has been a registered vacant building since 2009. I don't know if it was vacant for any length of time before that, so at least 10 years.
Okay, thank you.
Quite a long period of time for a neighborhood to sustain a vacant building.
This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to speak to this item? Sir, if you could just start by introducing yourself, let us know where you live, and then we have 5 minutes on the clock for you to share your perspective.
Okay, I'm Robert Schilling, 677 Sims in St. Paul. The building in question was my residence at the time. There was an inspector came. I had a friend, I guess you'd call him, that had dialysis, and his only hope was affordable rent or go to a nursing home. And he's since passed. But so for $300 a month, he was watching the place while I was on a different project. Inspector wanted to inspect for certificate of occupancy. He didn't let her in, and she posted it as registered vacant. So I moved him back out of there, and I moved back in myself, thinking that owner-occupied should maybe negate some of the issues that were happening, at least get it off the vacant building list. And it wasn't a scam, it was a legitimate thing. I was living there. Well, one day I came home and they're standing there with the sheriff and you're not sleeping here tonight. So everything got boarded up, the utilities shut off, the house froze up in the wintertime, side-by-side refrigerator, freezer sat and rotted away, and on and on, and then I've moved on to different things. It's been sitting that way ever since because I've had complications with my health, complications with my business, and different major shakeups that, time passed and here we are. The building is ready to be cleaned up and fixed. I've got thousands of dollars worth of building materials that are in the building, been in the building. And that part of the cleanup was to remove some of the product, the rolls of carpeting and whatnot. So it's ready to go. And through this process, the electricity has not been turned on. There was five different avenues of request trying to get that going, and it turns out I still don't have electricity on. And so it's hard to get people to cooperate with you when the building is cold and the building is dark and there's no electricity. So one thing has led to another, and here we are. It's been no complaints against the building. No sidewalks that aren't troubled or grass that's not cut. So it's not a nuisance building. And it's a sound building, just that it's been sitting and neglected and needs to be cleaned up. I did purchase it in 75. For some reason or another, they don't have the title registered. I don't have the title registered. I don't remember if it didn't get registered or if it did get registered and something went wrong. Part of the process of cleaning the house out was, I believe that the title was in the house somewhere. And we went through things with a fine-tooth comb and didn't show up. So now we have to go through the process of securing a title through legal channels.
Do you remember a property tax bill ever coming to you?
All the time. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Everybody, it was my house. I have one here that I ran across just the other day that I said, huh.
Ms. Mormon, I'll give you a second to peek in
your bag. Mr. Schilling appears to be the tax owner of record, and I'm thinking, looking at the documents I've seen, that that's been the case since the mid-1970s. He indicated, or at least our notes indicate, that he indicated in the legislative hearing that he had purchased the property on a contract for deed, that the contract was paid, and there was an issue after that registering. He's indicated to me just outside in the hallway, no, he owns it outright and always did. And so there's a big disconnect there on how one could own it outright and not have the fee simple title, you know, registered. So that is a concern, and that he's going to need to be dealing with.
Yeah. And I thought it was in my safe deposit box. Didn't have a key for it. Just spent $300 at the bank to get the lock drilled. But turns out that the abstract, which took up all the room, I figured that the deed would be in that, and none of them were there. Abstract was gone also. I did share the box with my brother, who is now deceased. The only thing I can think of is that he must have removed it for whatever reasons. Maybe he had other things he thought were more important that he put in it himself. I don't know.
Okay, I didn't mean to, if I got you off track, it seemed like you were wrapping up. I just had that question about the property taxes, because that for 45 years.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, and then, you know, it was a cash sale when I purchased it, so.
So you don't owe any money?
And there's no mortgage.
Okay, anything further?
I guess we'll work on getting the title done so we can move forward with everything else. I'm looking forward. I've got two personal reasons for wanting to get it done. I've got an employee that was in my employment for 40 years. He's had a stroke and doesn't get around well, and I care for him, make sure he gets his laundry and his meals and stuff like that. Short of my assistance to him, he'd be in a nursing home. And I wanted to put him in this house as soon as we got it done. Another reason is my daughter just recently got separated from her husband. She's living in South Carolina. He's in the Navy. And not knowing what's going to happen with her, it was probably going to end up being transitional housing to get her back to Minnesota. So I've got that in writing also. So there's reasons I want to get the place fixed up and done.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Tom moves to close the public hearing. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion prevails. And you can just hang out for a minute. We're going to talk a little bit amongst ourselves, but we just closed public comment period. So thank you very much. Mr. Tao.
Thank you. Mr. Sheldon, thanks for coming down here explaining your situation. I think by any standard, 10 years or over 10 years of a vacant building, it's really hard to accept, because that is an area that really needs some development, and so I'm real concerned about that. But what I'm going to do is we're going to lay this over for 15 days.
Could you refer it to legislative hearing March 10th, and then
10th?
I can review documents that he brings forward and that his attorney develops and report back to the council then on what's come up in that. Is that acceptable?
Yeah. So we'll connect with you. Our office will connect with you and bring in Ramsey County and other stakeholders to see what we can do to get this clarified and change the title. Okay. So I move for the layover until...
To move it, send it back to the legislative hearing officer on March 10th?
Yes.
Okay. And I would support that... layover, and I think a combination of things. One is it feels like someone needs to dig in and just do the work and figure out, like, kind of untangle this whole thing. But I do underscore what Mr. Tao said about, you know, you said this isn't a nuisance property. Well, based on the picture, I would say it is a nuisance property, and the neighborhood is a very challenged neighborhood, and a neighborhood where we have more counts of shots fired, and when places look like there's no one living in them, it contributes to a sense that there's, you know, it perpetuates some of those activities. And so I understand you have some reasons to want to move this forward more quickly, but that building has been vacant for a really long time, and it's hurting the North End community, and we can't afford to have you drag your heels anymore. So I'm very supportive of Mr. Tao's motion, and also want to make sure that you're hearing the council say this project needs to be completed if we're able to find a path forward in a very timely manner to help support our neighbors who have lived next to this house for the past 45 years that you've owned it. Any further discussion on the motion? All right, seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. The resolution is referred back to the legislative hearing for March 10th.
All right. And
Council President, I'm not aware of anyone else here to speak on the legislative hearing item.
Okay. So we are looking at items 16 through 22 on the legislative hearing consent agenda. Is there anyone here who is would like to speak to items 16 through 22, except 19? If so, this is your public hearing. All right, seeing none, Mr. Tom moves to close the public hearing and approve. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion prevails.
7 in favor, no one opposed. Public hearing is closed and the consent agenda is adopted as amended.
Okay, we have come to the close of business on our agenda. I'm looking at Ms. Prince right now.
For good news?
Well, yes.
Oh.
For guest news, no.
It appears we don't have
okay.
guests.
Okay, now I'm looking to Ms. Prince for
some
news
good
from
news.
Awards, yes.
Well, I want to invite everyone who has some gently used prime dresses and men's suits, ties, dress shoes, accessories that you would like to donate, Hazel Park Recreation Center on March 21st, 2020 will be having their prime dress suit sale. So March 21st is the date of the sale, but if you are cleaning out your closets and have some lovely dresses and suits and ties and so forth that don't fit anymore, drop them off up at Hazel Park. It's just a great event. Thank you.
Great. Other news from the wards.
It's actually in your
I'm trying to think what's in my closet.
I know.
Yeah.
I have a great Mardi Gras dress I'm going to bring, so thank you. Tomorrow morning at very early, 7:30 a.m., the Junior League is hosting a community breakfast on innovative solutions to affordable housing. It's actually not in my ward, it's, I believe, in Councilmember Jalali's ward, but Sunrise Bank's headquarters, 2525 Wabash Avenue. So be there, be square.
Or be sleepy.
Try not to use that pun again. It's not even.
Any other news from the ward? Oh, great. Well, seeing none, we are adjourned.